by prioritising that, but I will write to the member with more detail on that particular issue.
Thank you. We now move to First Minister's questions. Question number one, Kezia Dugdale.
To ask the First Minister what engagement she has planned for the rest of the day.
First Minister.
Later today, I will have engagements to take forward the Government's programme for Scotland. The Government is also today setting out details of the £379 million contribution we are making to a £504 million funding package to help boost economic growth in Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire.
Kezia Dugdale.
And that is investment, Presiding Officer, that the Labour Party very much welcome. The NHS is our most precious public institution. The dedicated staff who work in our health service help to bring us into this world and they care for us in our time of need. The delivery of NHS services depends on having motivated and well-supported staff. But this week, the scale of the pressure on our NHS because of SNP cuts and mismanagement was exposed. The Royal College of General Practitioners warned of a deepening GP crisis, and the RCN said that there needs to be a change in the health service, and quickly. Presiding Officer, our NHS is at breaking point. Hard-working, loyal staff are crying out for help. I wonder if the First Minister can tell me how many days were lost in our NHS last year due to staff stress.
First Minister.
Well, firstly, I agree that the NHS is our most valued, most cherished, most precious public service. I also agree that it couldn't and wouldn't be delivered without the dedication and the contribution of the staff working in our National Health Service. That's why, Presiding Officer, I am very proud that since this government took office in 2007, we've seen an increase in the number of people working in our health service of 10,500 people. We're also increasing the budget of the NHS next year by £500 million. And of course, as well as that investment, we've set out very detailed plans about how we want to reshape and reform the National Health Service to build up social care. So £250 million of that investment will be invested to increase social care, how we want to improve primary and community care to keep people out of hospital. But also when people do have to go into hospital, we plan 5 new elective treatment centres to make sure they can get that care quickly and efficiently. Finally, Presiding Officer, I noticed that Kezia Dugdale mentioned comments from the Royal College of GPs and the RCN, and we listen very carefully to what both of these organisations have to say. I noticed, though, that she omitted to mention the comment from yesterday of the Royal College of Emergency Medicine, which said that the UK has the best performing A&E services in the world and Scotland has the best performing A&E services in the UK. I think we should say a massive thank you to our NHS staff for that.
Kezia Dugdale.
I asked the First Minister about the stress that NHS staff are under, and she just clapped herself on the back as a result of all of that. She did. And yet again, that was a long response, but not actually an answer to the question that I asked. So let me give her the answer. Figures obtained by Scottish Labour show that last year, NHS staff lost more than 287,000 days because of stress. Wow. That's an increase of 21% compared to just 2 years ago. And this really matters because it puts vital NHS services facing SNP cuts under even more pressure. One of those services is the children's ward at St John's Hospital in Livingston, which is currently under review and potentially under threat of closure. Now, I know the First Minister will tell us it's a decision for the Health Board, but she has overruled officials before and she should do so again now. My constituents would like a simple yes or no answer to this question. Can the First Minister confirm, once and for all, that she will not allow the children's ward at St John's to be either closed or downgraded?
First Minister.
Well, firstly, can I say, in response to the point about stress of people working in our NHS, I started my answer to Kezia Dugdale by recognising the contribution of those who work in our NHS. But I also said, and this was a point that Kezia Dugdale clearly chose to ignore, that since this government took office, there has been an increase in the number of people working in our NHS of 10,500. So, yet again, Presiding Officer, what we have in this chamber is a divide between the Labour Party who come here and present what they describe as problems and an SNP government getting on with the job of delivering the solutions for our NHS and other public services in Scotland. And on the question of St John's Hospital, interestingly, Kezia Dugdale's first question was asking me to listen to the Royal College of GPs, to the Royal College of Nursing, which I said we always do. But her second question was asking me to say now, before an independent review has concluded, that I will ignore any recommendations for the Royal College for Paediatrics, which is the organisation carrying out the independent review that she talks about. But can I also say I will take absolutely no lectures from Scottish Labour when it comes to St John's Hospital in Livingston. Because when I took office as Health Secretary in 2007, Labour had taken away from St John's Hospital services like trauma orthopaedics and emergency surgery. There were concerns locally that St John's was going to be downgraded from being an acute hospital, possibly even closed as a hospital. Since then, this government has protected A&E services of St John's with consultant cover extended. We've invested £3 million in a new MRI scanner at St John's. We've invested £7 million in capital funding for short-stay elective surgery. There's been a £300,000 investment in respiratory services at St John's. We've refurbished the labour ward and the special care baby unit. We opened a new laboratory medicine training school. We've invested £3.3 million in an endoscopy unit. We've opened a regional eating disorders unit. And of course, of the five new elective treatment centres that we plan over the next Parliament, one of them is planned to be at St John's Hospital. This government has protected St John's hospitals from the cuts that were imposed on it by the former Labour administration.
Kezia Dugdale. Ms Dugdale, order. Order. Ms Dugdale.
Presiding Officer, if she's so good at protecting services at St John's, why can't she protect the Children's Hospital? Is that simple? Presiding Officer, the truth is that St John's isn't being reviewed or closed, it's just being reprofiled.
Yeah.
And actually, people can see that this government is pulling the wool over their eyes. Because it
Order.
Was just this week.
Order!
That's the reprofiler in chief, Presiding Officer, parking from the sidelines. Just this week, we had emails uncovered by my colleague Neil Findlay revealing that the Health Secretary had been pressurising officials to delay a decision into St John's until after the election. And now we know the First Minister won't guarantee that the children's ward will stay open. Kicking unpopular decisions into the long grass is becoming a hallmark of this government, and it's not just in the Lothians. We know that NHS Glasgow and Clyde is preparing for budget cuts of up to £60 million, including the closure of services and cuts to staff numbers. The First Minister has it within her power to stop this happening. She can save the Lightburn Hospital and protect the children's ward at the RAH. She can secure emergency care at the Vale of Leven and protect NHS staff numbers in Glasgow. So can the First Minister give today a 100% guarantee right now that all of these services will be protected in their current form?
First Minister.
I hate to be the bearer of more bad news, certainly bad news if you happen to be Kezia Dugdale. I was the Health Secretary that saved Lightburn Hospital in Glasgow. Possibly one of the many facts that has just escaped Kezia Dugdale's preparation for today's First Minister's questions. Can I give her a tip? It is really good when you're asking questions to be able to adapt the questions in response to the detailed factual answers that you get. The truth of the matter, Presiding Officer, is that this is the government that has protected St John's Hospital, protected St John's Hospital from the cuts that were planned to it by the last Labour administration. We will go on taking the decisions that protect St John's Hospital and hospitals right around our country. And finally, Presiding Officer, this time last week, if memory serves me correctly, Kezia Dugdale was asking me to invest more money in local authorities. Today she's asking us to put more money into the National Health Service. She's yet to tell us where any of this extra money is coming from. So I will issue an open invitation to her today. Here's the draft budget. It is a draft budget. I'm happy to pass it over, and if Kezia Dugdale wants to send it back to me, marking where Labour wants to cut things in this budget to pay for the extra money that they keep talking about, I'll be happy to listen. The fact of the matter is, Presiding Officer, we don't get any ideas from Kezia Dugdale or Labour. We just get whinging from the sidelines. The focus group that was published this week, that Labour tried to suppress,
order,
said voters,
order,
recall, voters recall Labour.
Order!
Out,
order! Order!
It's okay, Presiding Officer. I wasn't going to quote this. For Scottish voters, Labour is indistinguishable from the Tories, just less competent. I wasn't going to quote that. What I was going to quote was this one. Voters recall Labour trotting out a long list of policies with no conviction that they could deliver them. Nothing, absolutely nothing has changed. That shower's not fit for opposition, let alone government.
Kezia Dugdale. Ms Dugdale.
She read one quote there from a focus group, Presiding Officer. The only person acting like a Tory in this chamber this week is John Swinney, who's enforcing austerity on all the councils across Scotland.
Order! Order! Ms Dugdale! Order!
And again, Presiding Officer, in a very specific question about services in our hospitals across the country, there was no direct commitment to save these services, and that will be noted by everyone. Because the First Minister had a chance to provide much-needed relief to thousands of staff and families across the country. She could have guaranteed that the proposed cuts to NHS services would not take place, but she didn't do that today. So let that message go out to people across the Lothians, to patients in Glasgow and in Paisley, to families in Dumbartonshire, and to people the length and breadth of this country. Isn't it the case that whilst the SNP say they will protect our NHS, the reality is they are threatening our local services with the axe?
First Minister.
Look, yet again, we have from Labour whinging about what the SNP, in their view, is doing wrong, with no concrete proposals for what we need to do differently. Now, I am going to be asking Parliament, John Swinney is going to be asking Parliament in a few weeks' time to vote for a budget that delivers extra funding of £500 million to the NHS next year. For the first time, the budget for the health portfolio is going to reach £13 billion. I think when we took office, it was £9 billion. There are 10,500 more people working today in our NHS. We've protected local services that Labour were planning to close. Does anybody remember Monklands and Ayr accident and emergency units that were facing the axe under Labour that are still open treating patients today because this SNP government saved them? So I am more than happy, Presiding Officer, to put the health record of this government to the people of Scotland in a couple of months' time and ask them to judge it against the woeful record and the woeful present record of this Labour opposition.
Question number two, Ruth Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the First Minister when she will next meet the Secretary of State for Scotland.
First Minister.
No plans at present.
Ruth Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The long-anticipated Aberdeen City Region deal will be signed today, paving the way for a £250 million investment package in the Aberdeenshire economy. It is good to see the North East getting the help that it needs to support jobs. So I welcome today's deal, and I hope it holds out for a brighter future for both the city and the Shire. On top of this, the Scottish Government has announced extra infrastructure funding, including £200 million to increase capacity on key rail links between Aberdeen and the Central Belt. That work has been on the books since 2007, the entire lifetime of the Scottish Government. So can I ask the First Minister to confirm that this money is new when it's being released and when the work will be carried out?
First Minister.
Well, all of the money we have announced today will be available to Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire to benefit those areas over the same timescale as the city deal. And just to recap, there's been a funding package of £504 million provided for Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire today. £125 million of that is coming from the UK Government, and we're very grateful for that. £379 million is coming from the Scottish Government. Now, there's many transport projects that we want to do, but in order to do them, we have to prioritise them and find the money. What we're doing today is committing the money for the improvements that will speed up rail links between the Central Belt and Aberdeen, and I would hope that Ruth Davidson would warmly, without any equivocation, welcome that. In addition to that, we're announcing money for trunk road funding, including the Lawrencekirk Junction, which is something that has been required for a long time. We're also giving certainty to Aberdeen, which other councils don't have, about their housing investment over the next 5 years. We're announcing money for housing infrastructure and additional money to help with digital connections in Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire. That's a good package. I'll be in Aberdeen on Monday making further announcements about how the Scottish Government will focus on helping the oil and gas sector in particular.
Ruth Davidson.
I'd like to thank the First Minister for that reply. Our party is and always has been for healthy competition, so I'm delighted to see the Scottish Government trying to outdo the UK Government today. I think it's important that our two governments actually work together, and this is exactly the kind of partnership that I believe most people in Scotland want to see. However, I can't let this moment pass without raising one key point. If the First Minister had her way, we would right now be 8 weeks away from separation. And I'd like to ask her, in all honesty, what situation she thinks is better for Scotland today. The one we have, with our two governments, with all of their resource stepping in to support the North East at this time, or the one that she hopes for, preparing for a life outside of the UK, with oil at $30 a barrel and Scotland's finances about to be blown to pieces.
There's no difficulty in answering that question. I think this government, this parliament, this country, having all the powers we need to grow our economy, is by far the better position for us to be in. But you know, given that the Prime Minister is going to be in Aberdeen today, perhaps this is a moment I can't let pass either, because there's a lot of focus, understandably so, on what the Yes campaign said about oil during the referendum. But do you know what? Much to my regret, and it is to my deep regret, the Yes campaign didn't win the referendum. The No campaign won the referendum. So maybe we should look at what the No campaign said about oil during the referendum. Here's what David Cameron said in February 2014. £200 billion oil boom if Scotland votes no. Maybe when he's Aberdeen today, he can tell us what happened to it.
Order. 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 Right, I have two constituency supplementaries. Firstly, Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Without knowing the welcome additional funding from the Scottish Government, the Press and Journal today described the £250 million Aberdeen City deal as slightly underwhelming. It amounts to only about one-third of the investment that has gone into the AWPR. Does the First Minister share my view that Aberdeen deserves more from the UK Government than the £125 million they have allocated, particularly considering that the Treasury has benefited from over £300 million of North Sea oil revenues that have flowed from Aberdeen to London?
First Minister.
I think Kevin Stewart makes a very, very good point indeed. But nevertheless, today I think is a good day for the northeast of Scotland. As I've already said, I welcome the City Deal Agreement, which is seeing both the Scottish and UK Government commit £125 million to support infrastructure and innovation in the northeast. However, I do know that the investment Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire asked for was more significant than that. That is why we have taken the decision, as the Scottish Government, to today confirm £254 million of additional support for key infrastructure in the North East. And of course, as I've already said, that brings the total amount of Scottish Government support announced for the North East today to £379 million. The Cabinet Secretary for Infrastructure did invite the UK Government to match that additional commitment, and we'll continue to discuss with them increasing their contribution. Lastly, Presiding Officer, as members will be aware, the Cabinet discussed the challenges facing the North East earlier this week, and I'll make further commitments to support the industry when I visit Aberdeen on Monday.
Duncan McNeill.
The First Minister will be aware of the announcement made yesterday by Texas Instruments that intends to cease production at its Greenock plant and relocate to America, Japan and Germany, potentially with the loss of 365 jobs. I'm sure the First Minister will agree that this would be an undeserved fate to the highly skilled and committed workforce at the plant, and indeed to an already fragile Inverclyde economy. A glimmer of hope, of course, does exist, and that we still have time to attract a new owner to the plant. Will the First Minister take this opportunity today to commit the Scottish Government and its agencies to play a full role in the task force set up by Inverclyde Council leader yesterday, Stephen McCabe, in order that we can attract a new owner to secure those jobs and indeed address the underlying fragility of the Inverclyde economy?
First Minister.
Yes, I will give those commitments in full. I appreciate that this will be an extremely worrying time for employees of Texas Instruments and their families. As Duncan McNeill rightly points out, Texas have made clear they want to sell the plant as an ongoing concern, saving as many of the jobs as possible. And they've also made clear that they wouldn't anticipate any jobs in any event being lost until late 2017. So that does mean we have an important window of opportunity to work with the company to do everything we can to help find a buyer that will maintain jobs in Greenock. Scottish Enterprise are fully engaged. They will work with the company to explore all possible options for supporting the business and retaining jobs, and the Scottish Government will be fully engaged in that work as well. I can tell the Chamber that Fergus Ewing has today written to the leader of Inverclyde Council, saying that the Scottish Government will support the task force in any way we can and suggesting a meeting on Monday of next week. So we will do everything we can to preserve this company and the jobs in it, and no stone in that regard will be left unturned by this Government or our agencies.
Question number three, Jim Hume.
To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's response is to the Committee on Climate Change's concerns that its spending on climate change is set to be reduced in 2016-17.
First Minister.
Well, we continue to spend significant sums on climate change mitigation, with budgets totalling more than £900 million over 2 years, supporting progress towards our world-leading targets. The UK Government, of course, is, and I think this is a widely recognised fact, is hampering the renewable energy sector and putting at risk millions of pounds of investment in the Scottish and UK economy. If they had kept their previous commitments, the viability of many projects would not now be in question and Scottish Government support would have been maintained. In addition, of course, the Scottish UK Government's decision to cut the Green Deal Home Improvement Fund has directly led to a £15 million cut in consequential support for energy efficiency. The Scottish Government will continue to argue against the UK changes to energy policy, as we've done consistently. And, of course, across other areas, we've seen an overall increase in our budgets of £13.3 million.
Jim Hume.
Thank you. Well, the question was actually about the Scottish budget. Everyone who has looked at her budget can see climate change funding has been hammered. £50 million less in 2016. It's not the first time the green energy budget has been the victim. In 2013, it was released for other projects. In 2015, funds were reallocated to other priorities. And in 2014, it wasn't cut. It was reprofiled. So when the First Minister got off the plane from Paris and said the rest of the world should be like her, did she want them to hammer their climate change budgets too?
First Minister.
If Jim Hume had been listening, he would have heard that my answer was actually about the Scottish Government budget. If you exclude the changes to the Scottish Government budget that have been necessitated by the changes to UK energy policy, we can't spend money on things that UK energy policy don't allow us to spend the money on. If you exclude those changes, then what you see is Scottish Government budgets in this area have increased by £13.3 million. That is the reality. Now, I would hope that Jim Hume, notwithstanding funding his party's previous coalition with the Conservative Party, would join the Scottish Government in arguing that the UK Government's changes to energy policy are wrong-headed. They're harming our ability to meet climate change targets and to discharge our obligations to the environment, but they're also harming not just the Scottish economy, but the UK economy as well. So I look forward to having Jim Hume's support in future in that regard.
Brief supplementary, Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. The First Minister once again describes Scotland's targets as world-leading. But the world is leading from a 2-degree threshold to a 1.5-degree threshold in the Paris Agreement. The world is leading toward greater ambition, and the Scottish budget seems to be leading in the other direction. Why on earth can we take that seriously?
First Minister.
As I pointed out, that is not the case. If we take out the impacts of UK government policy, we're actually increasing our commitment to the environment and to meeting climate change targets. And, you know, I am absolutely convinced that we have a responsibility to do that. And, you know, interestingly, when I was in Paris, it wasn't just me that was talking about not just Scotland's targets, but Scotland's performance as world-leading. It was other countries that were describing Scotland's targets and performance in that regard. I recognise we've got a responsibility over the lifetime of the next Parliament to intensify and to accelerate our work if we are to play our part in taking the world to a more ambitious place on climate change. And I am determined, as are my fellow ministers, that we do exactly that.
Question 4, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister whether the Scottish Government will provide an update on discussions on the fiscal framework.
First Minister.
Deputy First Minister met the Treasury again to discuss the fiscal framework last week. Discussions between our respective officials have been ongoing all of this week, and the Deputy First Minister will meet the Chief Secretary to the Treasury again next week to try to get a fair deal for Scotland on the fiscal framework. Let me say again, Presiding Officer, I want a deal on the fiscal framework. I want Scotland to get the additional powers that were promised to Scotland, but I will not, as First Minister, sign up to an agreement that is unfair to the people of Scotland.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the First Minister for that answer. Does she agree that it is of crucial importance to get the balance right in these negotiations to ensure the Smith principle of no detriment to either Scotland or the rest of the UK is embedded in the fiscal framework? And does she share my astonishment that Tory MSPs have been urging her to sign a deal regardless of whether or not it is good for Scotland, showing once again that the Tories always put London's interests first rather than the interests of the people of Scotland?
First Minister.
I agree with that. Let me make very clear, the Scottish Government is working in good faith to try to deliver a deal that is fair to Scotland and indeed fair to the UK on issues like the block grant adjustment, set-up costs, capital borrowing, dispute resolution, all of these issues are important. But we won't sign up to a deal that systematically cuts Scotland's budget regardless of anything this government or future Scottish governments were to do. I think the big question now is whether the Tory government in London is also going to act in good faith to try to get that deal. I'm not sure I am astonished that Tory MPs are asking us to sign up to a deal that won't be good for Scotland. I have to say, though, I am pretty aghast that Labour appears to be asking us to do that. You know, this is a negotiation between the Scottish Government and the Tory Treasury, and it is astounding how quickly Scottish Labour defaults to take the side of the Tory Treasury. It seems the Better Together alliance is alive and well.
Question number 5, Cara Hilton.
What action the Scottish Government is taking to ensure that every foster carer receives a minimum allowance?
First Minister.
We are planning a national review group with representatives from COSLA, Social Work Scotland and Fostering Network. The group will agree a methodology for calculating allowances based on the needs of children living in foster and kinship care, what the minimum rates of allowance will be and a suitable timetable for their introduction. The group's work will begin early this year and will conclude as soon as possible. Implementation of a new system will of course take account of any new welfare powers accruing to the Scottish Parliament. Of course, as a preliminary step towards a fair and transparent system of allowances for both kinship carers and foster carers, we're providing £10.1 million of funding per year now to councils to ensure kinship care allowances are set at the same level as foster care allowances, and that will improve the lives of around 5,200 children.
Cara Hilton.
Can I thank thank the First Minister for that answer. Research published last week by the Fostering Network revealed a wide variation in the payments that foster carers receive from one Scottish local authority to the next, with allowances varying by as much as £127.31 per child per week. 88% of Scottish local authorities pay less than £159 a week, which is the national minimum allowance foster carers in Wales receive. And last year, more than half of local authorities in Scotland froze fostering allowances, meaning in real terms cut. So it's 9 years now that since the Scottish Government first proposed to develop a national minimum allowance. I can hear the promises today, but I think 9 years on, I do think foster carers remain shortchanged compared to the rest of the UK. And 5,000 children a year continue to be looked after without the security of a national minimum allowance. So foster carers need more than promises. Will the First Minister act now to end the postcode lottery and deliver a fair deal for Scotland's foster carers?
First Minister.
It might interest Cara Hilton to know that one of the local authorities that pays under £100 a week is Fife, which is a Labour minority council. But actually, the key issue is more important here. Scottish Government guidance already recommends that councils use the fostering network's annually reviewed recommended minimum allowances. And I think the fostering network, and indeed Cara Hilton, is right to raise this issue, because we do need to see a national level of caring allowances so that foster carers, kinship carers, are treated fairly in every part of Scotland. That's why the work I've described is so important, and I hope it has the full support of Cara Hilton and indeed the rest of the Chamber.
Question six, Liz Smith.
To ask the First Minister what role the Scottish Government considers that cadet forces play in society.
First Minister.
There's a long tradition in Scotland where the Army cadets make a contribution to youth work. This work provides structure and support, as well as interesting and challenging activities for the young people who choose to become involved. The cadet forces in Scotland, along with other youth uniformed organisations, contribute to the implementation of the National Youth Work Strategy. So we note and welcome the contribution the Army cadet forces located in communities across Scotland makes to improving the skills and abilities of our young people.
Elizabeth.
Given the First Minister's very positive reply, will she confirm that the completely unacceptable description of the UK cadet recruitment process as cannon fodder, which so angered all our cadet forces, is not the official view of the Scottish Government? And has she asked the spokesman who made these comments to apologise?
First Minister.
Well, as Liz Smith knows, I immediately said that that was not appropriate language to use about our cadet forces, and I've made that clear to anybody and everybody who is willing to listen, and I do so again. As I said in my answer, we appreciate the contribution that cadet forces make, and of course all of us across this chamber appreciate very deeply the contribution that all of our armed forces make to Scotland and to keeping all of us safe.
Thank you. That ends First Minister's questions. We now move to members' business. Members leave the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.